Today I am going to discuss with you all about the proteins and enzymes that are involved in your DNA replication in prokaryotes. Well, these are the list of proteins and I will try to mention the functions each all of them. So the first protein is your DNA A. DNA A is the initiator enzyme which actually unwind the DNA at the origin of replication, and with the help of ATP they do this work. Then comes DNAB. DNAB is your helicase. It just acts like a zip opener, unwinding the two DNA strands. Okay, and it leads to the formation of replication fork also. So replication fork, I will try to explain in the next video. Here also try to brief little bit, I will try to explain. DNAC, it is actually called as helicase loader. DNAC is your helicase loader, which actually helps the DNAB to interact with the DNAA and bind at the unwinding site of origin. The SSBP is your single-stranded DNA binding protein. It binds to the single-stranded region of DNA, and its main job is to prevent rewinding of the DNA until the replication process is complete. The new synthesized strand has been fully synthesized. Then only it will move from that single-stranded DNA. And another function is to protect that single-stranded DNA from being degraded by the nuclease enzyme, because all this DNA replication event occur within the nucleus at the S phase of your cell cycle. DNAG is your primase, which synthesize small RNA molecules called as primers, which initiate your DNA synthesis actually. Then with the help of that primer, DNA polymerase 3 start to catalyze, synthesize the strands from 5 prime to 3 prime direction. DNA polymerase 1 and 2. DNA polymerase 1 actually removes that RNA primer later on, because we need full strand of DNA, so DNA polymerase 1 removes that RNA primer and synthesize DNA in that place. DNA polymerase 2 is mainly associated with repair of DNA. Suppose if some mistakes are done by DNA polymerase 3 or some external agents causes change in the base pair of the DNA, which we will known as mutation, then DNA polymerase 2 try to rectify those mistakes that was done by DNA polymerase 3. Then comes DNA ligase. DNA ligase, normally it joins the two strands. It joins the two strands with the help of phosphodiester bond, and for this activity they needs ATP. Okay. Last one is the topoisomerase 1 and 2. It normally overcome the supercoiling of DNA. Supercoiling of DNA normally occurs when your DNA starts to unwind, done by DNA A, and later on it is done by DNA B. Okay. Then what happened ahead of the replication fork, ahead where the unwinding is taking place, ahead of that unwinding region, we'll see some more overwinding in the DNA. A knot type structures are observed, that is called as supercoiling. So to overcome that supercoiling, topoisomerase 1 and 2 come into action. They actually cut the one of the strand or two of the strand, depend on what type of topoisomerase we are using, and then it try to remove that knot, try to remove that overwinding of DNA, okay, and then again reseal that gap by their ligase activity. Okay. So this was a little bit overview of your replication, the enzymes involved in replication. Now I am now trying to discuss about each of them in detail. Okay, so first one that we will see is about the DNA A. Okay, what is DNA A? DNA A with ATP, right? DNA A is made up of four domains. What are domains? Domains are generally defined as your part of a protein structure which can fold independently of the remainder of the protein. And domains are actually distinct functionable. Okay, they are observed by their functions that they do actually, or structural units of a protein. So domains are actually simply, in simple words, they are the regions. Okay, so DNA A is made up of four domains. And what are those four domains? The first domain is the N-terminal domain. All proteins have a N-terminal domain. It has a N-terminal domain at one end and carboxy-terminal domain or C-terminal domain at one end. The N-terminal domain is the amino-terminal domain, while the C-terminal domain is the carboxy-terminal domain. Just like in case of DNA, it has a 5 prime at one end and 3 prime at one end. 5 prime is actually the phosphate group that we are referring, and 3 prime is the hydroxyl group or the OH group that we are referring, right? In the same way, in case of protein structure, they have an N-terminal end, which is actually the amino-terminal end, and at other end, it has a C-terminal end or carboxy-terminal end. Depend on, we know the structure of the amino acids, it has an amino group, it has a carboxyl group. So arrangement of the amino acids in the to form a polypeptide chain leads to the formation of these terminal ends. So DNA A is made up of four domains. The first domain is your amino terminal domain, which is associated with the regulatory proteins for the replication process. Second is your helical linker domain. Okay. Third domain of DNA A is AAA region, which binds with the ATP. This domain is that region of the DNA A which binds with the ATP, because without ATP it will cannot able to carry out its unwinding function. And the fourth domain is the C-terminal DNA binding region. So DNA A has four domains which have respective functions. Like the fourth domain that I have said of DNA A, it is associated with the DNA binding region. The third domain of DNA A associated with binding of ATP. Second domain is the helical linker region. It links the of these other domains. And the first domain is the amino terminal domain, which is associated with the regulatory proteins, right? Regulatory proteins means the proteins which are involved in regulation of the DNA replication process. So the C terminal half is involved in DNA binding as mentioned here. Now DNA A binds to the REC region in order to melt the DNA for initiating the DNA replication process. So normally REC is your origin of replication. Okay. Now here in case of prokaryotes, DNA A first initiate your replication process by binding with the REC region. Why? To melt the DNA, to unwind the DNA for initiating your DNA replication process. Now the REC site in E. coli has 380 rich regions of 13 base pair each of them, and it is followed by 9 base pair regions with the sequence of TTAT, C or A, CA, that is C or A or A. So this is the sequence that is found within the E. coli. So I try to explain this with the help of a diagram. Okay, so I am zooming in. So if you see, wait for a minute. If you see, if this is the origin of replication of E. coli, the region, okay, the 5 prime and the 3 prime, then there is a 3 AT rich regions. Okay, these are the AT rich regions. So there are 3 AT rich regions. Known as the 13 mer, it is known as the 13 mer because it is made up of 13 base pairs, okay, and those 13 mer is rich in AT, okay, it is rich in AT sequence, okay, and it has a sequence in this way. If I mention you with you, it has this sequence of GATC, GATC, TATTT, TATTT, ATTT. So much of adenine and thymine sequence are present in this 13 mer region, which is the AT rich region. And why it has this AT rich region so much? Because it is in this region that DNA will unwind, okay, the DNA will unwind the DNA and allows the other proteins to initiate their functions, okay. So it is a 13 base pair rich sequence, that's why it is called as 13 mer, okay. Now it has also other regions as well, that is your 9 mer region. There are about 5 9 mer regions. So these are the 9 mer regions. I'm trying to draw as, because it is difficult to draw by hand. So there is 9 mer regions, 9 mer, because it has your 9 base pair sequence as in each of these 9 mer regions, and it is the site where DNA A first bind. DNA A first bind to these 9 mer regions, and then it will, some distortions will occur, some change in the structure occurs in the DNA, folding occurs, that leads to the unwinding of these 13 mer regions later on. Okay, so this was the thing. So these 9 mer regions have the sequence, okay, it have the sequence. What sequence it has? The 9 mer regions have this sequence TTAT, C or A. The next nucleotide, it may be C or it may be A, then C or A again, then A, okay, that leads to the formation of 9 mer. Okay, wait for a minute. So these 9 mer regions that I have drawn just now, I will also show with the help of diagram more, because this is a general diagram that you can draw, that I have drawn before. But there are also some associated regions as well, you will see, for the additional binding of the regulatory proteins. So these 9 mer regions are also called as DNA A binding site. These 9 base pair regions that we are talking about, the 9 mer regions, these 9 mer regions are also called as DNA A binding sites. Okay, it is also known as DNA A binding sites. Okay, because it is in these sites DNA A first bind. DNA A first bind. Now there are about 8 DNA A binding sites within the origin of replication, right? Okay, I have skipped many pages. So around 10 DNA A molecules bind to these 9 mer regions, which wrap around the proteins and thus causing the DNA at 80 rich regions to unwind and form the replication bubble. So about 10 DNA A molecules, they bind to this 9 mer region. Remember, the 9 mer regions are the regions that I have said, the DNA A binding sites. There are about 5 9 mer regions. In this 9 mer regions, 10 DNA A molecules bind and wraps around the protein and thus causing the DNA at 80 rich regions to unwind and form the replication bubble. Remember, the replication bubble is the unwinding of the DNA strands leads to the formation of replication bubble. So this is your replication bubble, this one, where unwinding has taken place and initiated by your DNA A. Okay. Now these denature 80 rich regions that has been unwinded by DNA A, it allows recruitment for DNA B, which is helicase, which complexes with DNA C, known as helicase loader. So these denature 80 rich regions will allow recruitment of DNA A and DNA C. Okay, so more I have to explain about the DNA A. Let us see. So this much is about DNA A. Now more information about DNA A. It is saying that all functions of DNA A proteins depend on its ability to bind to an asymmetric 9 base pair region or recognition sequence, which is called as 9 mer, the DNA A box. So the first function of DNA A is to bind at these 9 mer regions that I have said. So they will first, DNA A will first bind to these 9 mer regions, and this is the sequence of these 9 mer regions I have already said. Well, the N here that is given here, the N may be C or A, it may be cytosine or adenine attached, right? Okay, so first is, it is binding with this 9 mer region. A replication origins or EC usually consist of an arrangement, or you can say array, of several DNA A boxes. I have shown you that there are about 5 DNA A boxes. Okay, binding of DNA A to such an array origin recognition, it is the first step in the assembly of a specialized nucleoprotein complex, which is called as initiation complex. So when DNA A first bind to this 9 mer region, there will be some changes in the structure of that particular region. Maybe folding occurs in that area that causes close association with the 13 mer regions and leads to the formation of an initiation complex. So initiation complex consists of DNA, a protein binds to with the 9-mer regions, which is called as DNA A boxes. So due to the binding of DNA A protein to the DNA A boxes, there will be some structural changes, or you can say structural distortions of the DNA, which will allow the DNA A to load means to bind the to allow the binding of DNA B. So as DNA A protein bind with the DNA A boxes, remember again I'm repeating, DNA A boxes are your 9-mer regions that I have shown with to you in green color. So due to binding of DNA A protein to the DNA A boxes, there will be some structural distortions, means structural change in the DNA, that allows to bind the DNA B, which is a helicase on that site. Now in E. coli, as we are using the model organism E. coli, so the origin of replication in E. coli contains 260 base pair of 5 DNA A boxes. So there are 5 9-mer regions and at its left end, and an 80-rich region consisting of 13-mer repeats, the so-called 80 cluster. The 80-rich region that I have shown to you, that 80-rich region, each of them have 13 base pair regions, 13 base pair sequence, and that's why they are called as 13-mer, and they are also known as 80 cluster. Now in addition, there are also some other binding sites in that origin of replication. What are those other binding sites in that origin of replication? You can see I have shown, try to minimize the complicated diagram. So I have shown you the other binding sites as well, other than this 80 rich regions, which are the 13-mer, then the DNA A boxes, which are the 9-mer. The red triangle one that I have shown is the DNA A boxes. This one are the 9-mer. Okay. And these are the 80 rich regions, which are the 13-mer. But additionally, there are also some other binding sites found within the origin of replication in E. coli. And those are the sites for binding of some regulatory proteins like IHF, FIS, and some control factors like ICIA, ROB, HNS. So these are all regulatory proteins. These are all regulatory proteins which associate with the replication process, but whose functions are not known yet. It has not been explained properly that what they do actually, but overall we know now that they are involved in regulation of DNA replication process. Now special sequence are also found within this origin of replication. There are some special sequence which are also found within the origin of replication, and that are your this GATC sequence. This GATC sequence are also very important, not in replication actually, but in DNA repair. So in DNA repair process, they play an important role in prokaryotic repair process. So there are these GATC sequence are found distributed throughout the origin of replication and also throughout the genome of your E. coli DNA, also in other prokaryotes as well. So it is saying that the importance of these 11 GATC sites, the GATC sequence, are shown as blue boxes, okay, inside the sequence where IHF bind, inside where FIS where binds. You can see that between the 9-mer regions also GATC sequence are also observed. These GATC sequence are important for DAM methyl transferase in repair of DNA. So DAM methyl transferase, it is an enzyme involved in DNA repair. They actually methylate this GATC sequence at the adenine residue. It simply means that if this is the GATC, if this is the, if GATC is observed by DAM methylase, then what does it do? It on the adenine side, it will try to methylate that region, addition of methyl groups, that is called methylation, that is done by DAM methylase. And what is the importance of binding of DAM methylase is that the repair enzymes can able to understand which strand has to be repaired, because the newly synthesized strand, if mistakes occur done by the replication machinery somehow, then the repair enzymes can able to identify that which is the new strand, which is the old strand, and which strand we have to repair. Because the newly synthesized strand has not been methylated by this DAM methylase. So DAM methylase does not methylate the newly synthesized strand quickly. It will methylate slowly after the replication process is fully complete. But the old strand has been methylated by this DAM methylase at this GATC region. In each GATC region, the adenine residues are going to be methylated, right? So the repair enzymes can identify which is the old strand, which is the new strand, because the new strand has not been methylated by on this GATC sequences. Thus the repair enzyme can able to understand and identify that which strand I have to repair actually. Obviously a newly synthesized strand has to be repaired. So that is the mechanism actually, the importance of GATC sequence. So here you can see, the more briefly I have tried to explain about the origin of replication in E. coli. So the previous diagram that I have drawn, I have shown only the 80 rich regions, the 13 mer and the 9 mer regions. But here I have also shown the additional binding sites for the regulatory proteins like IHF, like binding sites of FIS, right? And in addition, I have also shown you the GATC sequence as well. So this is a simplified diagram where you can draw this. Okay. So DNA A protein bind to this 9 mer region in the REC as a monomeric units. Monomer means single unit, okay. So DNA A protein bind to these 5 binding sites in REC as a monomer, and by binding to this DNA A region. So when DNA A bind to the 9 mer region, which is the DNA A box, it causes a 40% bend in the DNA. That leads to closeness of the DNA A to the 80 rich region. So the DNA A become close to the 80 rich region by this bend. So when DNA A protein binds to this 9 mer region in the REC as a monomer, it causes a 40% bend at each site. And only when DNA A is complexed with ATP, it becomes active in initiation. Then ATP DNA A binds to the additional sites. These sites are predominant in AT rich region, which is then unwound, means unwinded, and subsequently stabilized due to specific binding of ATP DNA A to the single stranded ATP DNA A boxes. So simple thing, first DNA A binds to the 9 mer region, which is the 9 mer region, which is the DNA A boxes. And when DNA A bind to this this DNA A boxes, it causes a bend in the DNA, 40% bend. And then this ATP DNA A complex, they binds to the additional sites as well, like they bind with at the AT rich region, which is your 13 mer, which is then unwound, and subsequently they are stabilized due to specific binding. So in this way, by interaction, by high affinity interaction at the DNA A boxes with the DNA A protein, it binds, it wraps around the protein, causing the DNA at the AT rich region to interact, unwind, right? Further, these denatured AT rich regions are allowed for binding with of the DNA B, which is a helicase, and DNA C. So DNA B and DNA C complexes with each other. DNA C is a helicase loader. It allows the binding of DNA B to the to that AT rich region, which has been unwinded just now by DNA A protein. So DNA C, as it is written here, it is a helicase loader. It interacts with the C terminus of DNA B. So at the C terminus of DNA B, which is the DNA A binding region, C terminus of DNA B, DNA B C terminus is the place where it interacts with the DNA B, and it helps to bind properly with the DNA at that AT rich region. So it is saying here that DNA C helps the helicase DNA B to bind to and properly accommodate that single stranded DNA at the 13 mer region, and this is accompanied by ATP hydrolysis. Just after ATP hydrolysis, DNA C will remove from the DNA B complex. So DNA C's main job is to allow the DNA B to interact at that AT rich region, and then at the 13 mer region, because the 13 mer region has been unwounded by the DNA A firstly, now DNA B will come and it will try to elongate that that unwinding process, right? And then it is accompanied by ATP hydrolysis, and due to ATP hydrolysis, the DNA C will remove out from the DNA B. Okay. So this is the picture that I have tried to show about DNA A. We see that DNA A has four domains: domain 1, domain 2, domain 3, and domain 4, the important regions. Domain 1 of DNA A interacts with your DNA B, that is helicase. It interacts with HU, DPS, DIAA, L2, HDA, DNA A oligomerization. DNA A oligomerization, it is a place, actually DNA A is found in monomeric units. So they associate as monomers, single units, to these DNA A boxes. I have said now about 10 DNA A molecules bind to these 9 mer regions. In this way, as a monomeric units, as a single unit, they bind to these 9 mer regions. So in this way, DNA A oligomerization occurs. Multiple monomeric units of DNA A associate with the 9 mer regions, and it is actually done at this region, specific regions of DNA A. Domain 2 is main involved in interaction with DNA B. So this is the region where the DNA A interact with the helicase enzyme. Domain 3 is the AAA plus domain, which is involved in DNA oligomerization. And domain 4 is the DNA binding site actually of the DNA A. Okay, so this was about the DNA A. I will try to discuss about the DNA B and DNA C as well. So just see the diagram now. Okay, wait for a minute. So as in this diagram it has been shown that prokaryotes have only one origin of replication. This is the origin of replication, and prokaryotic DNA are most of the case they are circular in form. So here topoisomerase plays an important role, whereas eukaryotes they have multiple origin of replication. So that as eukaryotic DNA are very large, so we need to quickly at the S phase of cell cycle we have to quickly catalyze the synthesis of new strands of DNA for your cell, for the further cell division process to occur. So that's why it has been shown in this way. So the second enzyme that I am trying to discuss with you is about DNA B. So we will discuss about DNA B now. DNA B is your helicase. Okay, so if you see that about DNA B, let us see. DNA B, this is the domain of DNA B. Okay, why these type of numbers are given actually? These are the length of the amino acids. Okay, now this is the N terminal end. Okay, I'm trying to show you. This is the N terminal end, which is the amino terminal end, and this is the C terminal end, which is the carboxy terminal end. Within 80 to 172 region, within 80 to 172 region, when that means within 80 to 172 regions where amino acid contain in this region, this is the place where DNA B interact with the primase enzyme. Primase is your DNA G. So primase is your DNA G, where it introduces small RNA primer. So within the regions of 80 and 172, these amino acid regions of DNA B interact with the primase enzyme. Then you can see that here in this region, within your 172 to 470 amino acid region, this DNA B, that is helicase, interact with the DNA C. DNA C is your helicase loader. It is a loader. Okay, helicase loader, and it also interacts with the ATP region also, because ATP is required for hydrolysis so that DNA C can go, okay, move again after loading. It has to be disassociated from the DNA B, okay. So let us see about DNA B. More information I have give, try to study this part also. I'm not going through this. So DNA B helicase, it is the product of DNA B gene. The helicase enzyme that is produced is a hexamer in E. coli as well as in many other bacteria. That means DNA B is made up of 6 subunits, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So DNA B is a hexamer. It has a 6 subunits in E. coli and other bacteria. The energy for DNA B activity is provided by NTP hydrolysis. What is NTP? NTP is your nucleoside triphosphate, just like ATP, adenosine triphosphate, GTP, guanosine triphosphate, CTP, cytidine triphosphate, TTP, thymidine triphosphate. So they require this NTP hydrolysis for its to function, because they are moving along the replication bubble and winding the DNA, breaking that hydrogen bonds between the strands, and for this we need energy, and that energy is given by this NTP. Either adenosine triphosphate is providing, or GTP or CTP or TTP. Most of the case we write ATP or GTP. Now mechanical energy moves the DNA B to the replication fork, physically splitting it in half. So they are so the energy driven by DNA B, it helps to move towards the replication fork, physically splitting it in half. Now, what is your replication fork actually? Replication fork is the area where the replication of DNA will actually take place. It is the point where DNA unwinding occurs, thereby, now that DNA unwinding is done by helicase DNA B. Initially it was done by DNA A, and allows the space for the enzymes to do their function, like primase, DNA polymerase 3 to work. So the replication fork is the area where the replication of DNA will actually take place. This replication fork will move in the direction from 5 prime to 3 prime. So the replication fork will move towards the 3 prime end, and helicase is moving in that direction to unwind the DNA strands, so that it allows that space that is needed by the enzymes like primase, polymerase 3 to do their work. Okay. So if I show the replication fork, it will be very well, it has not shown. Okay, I'm trying to show the replication fork. Okay, so this is your replication fork. This part is replication fork. This part is replication fork. Now, in this replication fork region, helicase binds, and helicase here binds. Okay, in these regions. And it is moving in from 5 prime to 3 prime direction, unwinding the strands. Okay, it is moving from 5 prime to 3 direction, unwinding the strands, and it is providing that space so that your primase can come and bind and carry out their replication function. DNA polymerase can catalyze the synthesis of newly synthesized DNA. Okay. So what happened, it is saying that binding of the deoxynucleoside triphosphate causes a conformational change which allows the DNA B to translocate. Means when DNTP binds, when deoxynucleoside triphosphate binds, there will be some conformational change in the structure of the DNA B, which allows the DNA B to translocate, means move along the DNA, and thus mechanically forcing the separation of the DNA strands. So binding of the nucleoside triphosphate causes a conformational change in the structure of DNA, so that the DNA B, so that it causes conformational change in the structure of DNA B, so that DNA B can move, it can translocate along with the DNA from 5 prime to 3 prime direction, and mechanically forcing the separation of the DNA strands. Now this same DNA B function in eukaryotes, it is done by MCM complex. MCM is your mini chromosome maintenance complex. The function that is done by DNA B here, which is called as helicase, in eukaryotes it is done by MCM, that is mini chromosome maintenance. So initially DNA B associate with DNA C, and then it associates with DNA G. Initially, DNA B associates with DNA C, which is a helicase loader, and then it associates with DNA G, which is primase. After DNA C is released. Due to the ATP hydrolysis, DNA C is then released out. Because its main function is to accommodate, its main function is to bind and properly accommodate the single-stranded DNA at the 13-mer region. So DNA C is helping the DNA B to bind to the single-stranded DNA at that 80-rich region, which was actually initially it was 13-mer, and then ATP hydrolysis occurs and it goes off. Now DNA B is a hexameric protein. That means it has 6 subunits, and each of the subunits have 471 amino acid residue. Each subunit is made up of 471 amino acid residue. So 471 into 6, that amount of DNA B interacts with the DNA at the replication fork, which forms a ring shaped structure with a threefold symmetry. So the helicase is moving along with the DNA helix, separating the two DNA strands at the 5'-3' direction. So this helicase, it is moving along the DNA helix, separating the two DNA strands at 5'-3' direction. Helicase also recruit the RNA primase. This will the next enzyme that we will discuss. So this helicase recruits the RNA primase, interacts it and activates it by forming a complex known as primosome. So DNA helicase, which is DNA B, DNA helicase and DNA G together known as primosome, PRIMOSOME. Just like initiation complex was done by DNA A when it binds with the DNA A binding boxes. Similarly, when your DNA B interacts with the DNA G, which is a primase enzyme, it initiates small RNA primers, it is known as primosome. Next is the DNA C. DNA C is a helicase loader. Its function is to they associate with the DNA B, and it helps the helicase to bind and accommodate the single stranded DNA at the 13-mer regions. After loading the DNA B at the origin, then DNA C is released by hydrolysis action of ATP. Okay. So this was about your DNA A, DNA B and DNA C. Okay. Now I will try to discuss with you all about the DNA G, which is your primase enzyme. Primase enzyme introduces small RNA primer. This primase enzyme introduces small RNA primer. It is also known as DNA G. So what it is saying, let us see. DNA G, which is primase, it is a bacterial DNA primase and it is encoded by DNA G gene. The enzyme DNA G synthesizes small RNA strand known as RNA primer, also known as oligonucleotides, during DNA replication. These primers are the starting point for DNA synthesis, because DNA polymerase 3 cannot initiate the synthesis of a new DNA strand, but it has to it can only add new nucleotides to a pre-existing strand, and that pre-existing strand is your primer that is synthesized by the primase. That means totally newly synthesized strand cannot be catalyzed by DNA polymerase 3. DNA polymerase 3 synthesize new strand, right? But it can only synthesize new strand when there is a small pre-existing strand, and that pre-existing strand is provided by your primase. It is provided by your primase. Okay. DNA polymerase can only add new nucleotides to the 3' end. So when a primer is formed, let me try to explain. Okay. So when a primer is being formed, done by primase, suppose this is a primer. Now the primer have a 3' OH group and a 5' region also. Now DNA polymerase, what it do, it catalyze the synthesis of this primer. It catalyze the synthesis of new nucleotides, new strand, by adding nucleotides at these regions, at these 3' regions. Okay. So this is the main thing. With the help of a pre-existing strand, DNA polymerase can only add nucleotides to form a growing strand. Otherwise, it will not able to do that. Obviously, from 5' to 3' direction, DNA polymerase catalyzes the elongation of the nucleotides. But initially, this primer is being formed by the primase. In the same process, just like DNA polymerase 3 will do. Let us see how it do this. So let us see. In E. coli, DNA G or the primase associate through non-covalent interaction with the bacterial replicative helicase DNA B to perform its primase activity. So in E. coli, this primase, that is DNA G, through non-covalent interaction, means non-covalent means not by weak interactions like hydrogen bonding or van der Waal force of interaction by or ionic interactions. So through non-covalent interactions, DNA G associate with the DNA B. DNA B is a helicase and perform its primase activity. About 3 DNA G primase proteins associate with each DNA B helicase to form a primosome. So for making a primosome, there are 3 DNA G primase proteins, and 3 DNA G primase proteins associate with each molecule of DNA B helicase to form this primosome. Now primase tends to initiate the synthesis at specific 3 nucleotide sequence on single-stranded DNA. This primase tries to initiate the synthesis at specific 3 nucleotide sequence on the single-stranded DNA. So there are some important nucleotide sequences. Primase recognize that 3 nucleotide sequence, and then only primase do the function. Okay. Like in E. coli, this primase called DNA G, it identifies this sequence. What is the sequence? 5' CTG 3'. So by observing the CTG, then only primase initiate the synthesis. They observe the CTG at the parental strand, obviously. So by observing that 3 nucleotide sequence at the parental strand, then only it can synthesize its primer on the newly synthesized strand. Okay. Now, DNA G perform this catalysis of synthesizing primer near the site of replication fork, formed by the DNA B helicase during DNA replication. So I will try to explain this primase in the next video, okay, because of some problem, I am not able to continue now this part. So that's all for this lecture.